So I'll dive straight into the questions. Okay. Because your organizations, they are all moving forward to making impact on the community and society, mainly to understand the issue that all of you have addressed. So what are the challenges that you guys have faced and obstacles, and how have you guys overcome?
Challenges when you guys do the projects, the challenges you always find is commitment. Yeah, we have 1001 things to do. We have to juggle with our studies, we have to juggle with our work. Not many of us doing this full time. And we also have to juggle with our families, our friends, our day-to-day, our Avengers movies, you know. So many priorities we have to juggle with. But we always ask ourselves is that what is the one thing that you will be doing even though you face challenges, not enough sleep, not enough money, what is the one thing that you do? So when we found out what is the one thing that we really passionate and wanted to contribute on, then the priorities automatically will align to that. So commitment on our volunteers, commitment from ourselves is always a challenge. How do we balance that? The other thing is of course funding. Funding when we try to do our programs and our outreach. Nothing is cheap nowadays, you know. You travel from point A to different campus, you also need to pay petrol. So, and of course, we have much more plans that we want to do. So, funding is also one of the things.
Can I say I agree with you? Okay, funding. Okay, funding. Challenges, there will always be challenges. If there are no challenges, life won't be enjoying, happy or that. If you're very boring, let a lot of cholesterol in there. So, you want some challenges. I believe that you have to be ready with the challenges. But like Adrian said, how do you prioritize? You have a lot of things to do. And let me tell you something, the things that you want to do, if you're going to do all of them, the years given to you to survive is not enough. The things that you want to do is more than the amount of years that you will have. I want to do something and I realize that, oh, it will take me 200 years to all all this, but you have to prioritize your resources, your time, your money, your time management is actually regret. So don't be surprised if you see a lot of people who are really committed and really activists, they only sleep 3 or 4 hours a day. That's normal. Some of them 2 hours a day. Some of them don't even sleep at all for 1 or 2 days. Normal, huh? Right, okay, that's what I said.
I think that, wow, both of you guys covered most of it. Yeah, exactly. They do more of the work and then I just say yes, same. So pretty much for us it's funding. One of the things I was telling somebody is that Malaysia is now a middle-income country, which is great, but for NGOs sometimes it's the perception is difficult, meaning that international donors would rather give the money, understandably, to poorer countries than to give it to a country like Malaysia. So when you depend on local and you're depending on the government, it's hard because the funding has been cut in the economy. So funding is a basic issue. I think that volunteers, the commitment is a huge issue. We are volunteer run and a lot of times they don't come or they're late and we cannot really get sure annoyance or irritation by it because we know that your time is valuable. So, but it does affect us. So if you're going to volunteer, we really appreciate it. But at the same time, try to come. So.
Well, I just want to grab my mic because I like the mic. I just want to share with you one of the challenges that I think did resonate with all of us. Yeah. When I started my journey to work with the community, especially in environment climate change, the first obstacle is my parents. Hey, don't waste time lah! Waste study! Why you waste time when meeting and do your project for what? All of culture. Yeah. Don't work for NGO, go and work for become CEO, professional, drive big cars, you know. This was the story, the conversation at my dinner table most of the time when I started, at your age. But now, when my parents talk to me, when my sisters talk to me, when my sisters have a baby, yeah, last time when she said, I said, hey, this lah, choose what you eat, eat organic, you know, recycle, and better for your health. Now, last time she said, hey, all these rich men people do only, you know, organic eating cheap. I cannot buy organic, very expensive, blah, 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 blah. But now, with the baby, she's the one telling me, hey, this organic shop, not 100% organic, no, but this shop better. Because the priority in her life changes. Last time, she only thinks about herself. Now she thinks about her family and her children. So when this, but the challenge now is that you guys will also face the same negative obstacles, people barking behind you and say, hey, don't waste your time doing this. But which is why you must choose a field, a sector, a passion, that, something that will not shake your core. And persevere. Persevere, keep on doing it until the people around you support you and confident on what you're doing will make a difference one day. Yeah? So that's my little sharing. I hope that will keep that little fight in you running later on.
One last thing, sorry. No, based on what you just said about the passion, many of you guys are studying different things, IT, engineering, and I can say finance, that we could always use, even if you think, oh, you know, I'm doing engineering, it has nothing to do with NGO, it has a lot to do with NGOs. All of these skill sets that you guys have, you guys can bring that to the table for an NGO, okay? And you guys can ask us help for how we do it. Filmmaking, for example, we use it, our films that we've made are all from, people who have helped out and just wanted to share their skills. Okay, even a yoga teacher has taught our mothers to reduce their stress. So, yes.
People can help in any way, that is true. Because you did mention that volunteerism is a problem, but have it improved compared to what you guys first started off? You're kind of giving talks to people and raising awareness, and then is it that more youngsters are joining into the volunteerism?
Okay, I'm not sure whether, because we have to compare apple with apple. Now, the increase, I can see an increase in volunteerism, but maybe not because night, but because the awareness has spread. Okay? We need to do the same thing first and same thing second and see what's the difference. Do you see that the same thing you're doing is increasing the number of volunteers? But I'm happy, whatever it is. Even if my organization reduces our work, let's say 10%, I think people will still come to Econites because the awareness, the pressures, the awareness from outside factors, from the external factors, is causing a lot of people to volunteer. But again, compared to the increase of number of people in Malaysia, I think volunteerism still has a long way to go. Volunteerism is still something very, very new in Malaysia, relatively, because Malaysia is a country which is more focused on economic development. Work, 9 years now. People always tell your parents, will tell you, hey, why are you doing NGO work? You do go to some big companies, but other companies, for example, you go to telecom, you graduated in something. My friend graduated engineering, but went to NGO, you know, environmental NGO. Now, but luckily, he got very understanding parents. His parents believe that you do what you think is the best for you, and you like to do. You believe it's right. This is something that I would like to stress from what Adrian said just now. You have to believe in what you are doing. Don't care about other people, but once you know that this is the best thing, the right thing for me to do based on the information I have, I will do this. Because if you think you are doing the right thing, even if 7 billion people in this world say you are doing the wrong thing, you are doing the right thing. But if you are doing the wrong thing, even if 7 billion people in this world tells you are doing the right thing, you are still doing the right thing. If you are human and somebody says you are a tree, even 7 billion people tell you are a tree, you are still human. Correct or not? Who cares? You cannot make everybody happy. Okay? If you can make everybody happy, I want to learn from you. You know, I do something, sometimes 50 of my friends, only 2 will agree. The rest 48 don't agree with me, but I believe this is what I should do. This is what we call activism. Okay, you believe in what you're doing. Because the changes in this world, a lot, I believe all changes in this world are made first by one person. Then it spread. You cannot have everybody believe in change because people normally do not want change. They are happy with the way things are. If they want to change, they want to change in terms of the number of money they have in banks. That's the only thing they want to change. Okay?
For us, there are many factors that determine whether volunteers stay, like what you guys said. For us, we have seen that if you are able to build a strong relationship actually with your other fellow volunteers, then you want to stay. Like for example, we've had groups of friends that come. You found somebody who's like-minded in your school or your partner, and they join together and they're both passionate, then they stick together. Like a partner in gym is the same thing, here. But the other thing that's beneficial, the benefit of volunteering is that you have to be a nice person, a passionate person to volunteer, right? So when you go and volunteer somewhere, chances are you'll meet the same people. And if you're able to connect with those people, then the likelihood of you staying will increase. So, for us, it's volunteers are communities in themselves of like-minded people.
Ms.
Meehan,
is there anything to say?
Can I have a show of hands? Who have volunteered before? Who have picked up the rubbish on the floor before? Who have helped to hold the door before? Who have slowed down your car so that the car in front signaling tried to enter the road before? Who have planted a tree before? All these are volunteerism. Try not to think about volunteerism is about saving the world. Yes, you are part of the solution to saving the world. But every level counts. Every kindness, every love, every action that you volunteer counts. And that's what matters. If everyone in this world just chip in that little bit, the world will be a better place. So I believe that every one of us here are volunteers. We volunteer our time, we volunteer our money, we volunteer our efforts, we volunteer our Facebook shares. All these are kinds of helping the community, the civil society to move forward. So all of us plays a part in that. And when we discuss about volunteerism, we always have these different phases in life, in volunteerism as well. You guys are not in a very lucky time that we have a multitude, different NGOs, different courses, different varieties from kitchen, from soup kitchens to animals, to environment, to healthcare, to LGBT rights. We have so much to play with. And it's not so much of a stigma now if you volunteer for a religious NGO or a healthcare NGO. It's no longer a stigma. A couple of years back, it was. So, I would challenge you guys, if you try out in, say, organization A, you don't like it, go to organization B, let's say you try A and B is the same, let's say environment. Okay, maybe environment not your cup of tea. You want to try healthcare. You want to try children education. You want to try arts. Go on, explore. Until you find that calling, that passion that you really want. And also very important, like what our friends from PT says, is that the people inside the organization, because you will spend a lot of time with your fellow volunteers, you eat, you sleep, some will change underwear together, but that's a different issue. But you spend a lot of time to make sure that you play along and get work together well with your fellow volunteers, then your volunteering time tends to go longer.
And you guys have to very, from Mr. Adrian and Mr. Ami, you guys have organized like very various of different events to cater to the cause of your organizations, including Ms. Supreme. You have multiple events going on also. What are the improvements that you are hoping to see from the community itself to actually help cater to the cause of the organization?
Like I said, the agenda of Equal Nights, I realized that I was talking to some people out there after I was in Equal, and I only realized that the topic might not be very, very understood by some of the students. So no wonder when I ask, does anybody agree, disagree, or agree? Does anybody disagree? How can they disagree if they can understand? So I'm so sorry about that, but if you have any questions, then you can ask me. But like I said, the philosophy or the message of Equonize is to build a sustainable society. A society where people can make informed decisions, are educated. Education is not about me telling you what to do, but me telling you information, giving you information. And based on that information, both negatives and positives, pros and cons, you can make your own decision. Okay? I don't mind people agreeing with me, but what I appreciate more is somebody who disagree with me. Because when somebody disagree with me and tell me the reason, then I can refine my understanding. Sometimes I have to change my understanding, my belief. Because somebody told me something right. 2 + 2 is always 4. I will believe in that and I will die for that. Unless somebody comes to me and says, 2 + 2 is 5, I will prove you. Okay, you prove to me. If we can prove 2 + 2 is 5, I will agree 2 + 2 is 5. But you need to prove to me. Until now, I am right because nobody proved me I'm wrong. A theory is always strong. It's stronger not because a lot of people can prove it's right, because nobody can prove it's wrong. If you have a very strong theory and 10 theories saying, yes, it's right, this is the evidence, okay, no problem. But if you come, you just prove 1 evidence that it is wrong, there goes the theory out into the trade. No more, not even hypothesis. Okay? So you just need that 1. So if somebody can prove that I am wrong, I will change my understanding. Okay? Thank you.
Yes and no. Some of the improvements that we have had is that the HIV rate overall has gone down. Okay? But and more people are realizing that HIV is not a death sentence, that you can get treatment. And fortunately, the government is working hard at making sure people get treatment. There are some issues that are remaining, is that the stigma with among MSM transgender remains, and it's getting worse. And HIV rates among this population is also getting worse. Actually, all around the world, it's getting bad, and among this population, it's getting bad. So it's more like the dynamics are just changing. It's not necessarily that things are getting better. For example, drug use, HIV transmission through drug use has gone down, thankfully. But heterosexual transmission, that means people of your age, you know, are getting HIV, like, I mean, if the rate is not decreased, if the rate is staying the same. So every year you have 4,000 people who are getting HIV. That's only one sexually transmitted disease. There are other sexually transmitted diseases. So, So if you, that's, I guess.
So if you take the 4,000 divided by the number of population, and then it gets a percentage. So mathematically, the percentage is decreasing, correct?
I mean, mathematically the percentage is decreasing, but you still have, if you look at the actual numbers, still have 4,000 people every year who are getting it, and they're still facing the same issues.
Okay, but you maintain that.
But the other issues, but the problem is that because it's increasing certain rates in certain populations, it actually affects others. So, you know, one year it's increasing. Then the other big issue is that we don't even know many people who have HIV. That's the issue. We know that more and more people are having sex before marriage. That's what we know. What we don't know is how many of them are coming to get tested, especially among the conservative populations. You know, those people will not come and get tested. Then you have the refugees. There are a lot of refugees here, you know, and there are a lot of undocumented, documented populations. They don't want to get tested. And as you have more and more of those people, they don't get tested. So there are no way of us measuring those numbers.
Okay, I mean, let's say you have 100 people reporting. Or you know for sure they have HIV. Do you have any statistical figures saying that out of these 100 you have 20 more who do not report?
There are some numbers, but not among the refugees. Honestly, I do believe there are numbers. I didn't see those particular numbers talking.
So did I?
But among the certain populations, we don't have any numbers. And that's our biggest concern, because they don't come and get tested. And they don't get free treatment. That's an issue. That's a huge issue. These people can't afford, we can barely afford to live. Then the refugee population, who are not legally allowed to work, documented workers will go back home, they'll be exported at home, so they don't get tested. And then that goes also to the Malaysian population. So, there are new trends. One of them, it has decreased in certain areas, which is great, but then some of the other trends are concerning. So.
How many of you have sex before marriage? No, come on, it's not something we have to own up. We have to practice safe sex, you know, get the requirement safety measures if you want to do it. It's a choice. Make it an educated choice. Yeah? So just like sexually transmitted diseases, things like climate change effect doesn't care whether you are documented or undocumented, whether you're Malaysian, Syrians, Indonesians, or immigrants. When climate change happens, everyone has the same effect. Yeah? What we hope to see in the society, in our course, is that all of us know our part. The number of stones. Remember the lion story? The number of stones that each and every one of us is throwing. That is important. If every one of us knows our part, knows our contributions, knows our negative contributions, then our job is done. But until and unless that happens, we still need a lot of outreach. That's why we all keep on planting seeds into every person, every audience that we speak to. But the final message is, of course, never, we don't really encourage all of you to just
quit what you do and save the world. Yes, we want you to save the world, but in your own way. Be the CEO of Petronas and stop extracting fossil fuel and make Petronas a renewable energy company. Be the CEO of a financial company. Be the CEO of a very polluting manufacturing company and change the operation of it. I also challenge you to be the Prime Minister of Malaysia. No one gonna do it. You know, you guys, with your whatever you're studying, whatever you are believe in, whether in law, accounting, environment studies, or whatever you're studying, be the best in your field and influence decision making. Then, only then we have some chance of saving ourselves.
The last question before we move on into our next session would be, because all of us here are just youngsters, so we would, all of us here who are quite young, I mean everybody down here is very young, so we would like to know, or young at heart, we would like to know that from your point of view, when you were at their age, what was that you were doing and how did you start getting into being involved in such a field?
Well, I always know that life is short. You never know when you'll get hit by a car and you know.
You're low, right?
You know? Sorry to sound very... And so I always knew that I wanted to do some type of work, whether it's volunteering, whether it's my job, whether it's whatever it is. So my way I started was very funny because I was in finance, so very like money-making school, and that was fine because I always thought, okay, if I go into this field, I'll end up giving money and donating money. Then I realized I was terrible at it, and I also have no passion for it. So I ended up moving to microfinance, then micro health insurance. Micro health insurance is health insurance for the poor, basically. And it's a very interesting field and very difficult field to enter into. Then I got into public health, and this is through my jobs. So one of the things I learned from that is find your passion. It doesn't have to be necessarily in school, but it can be out of school. It can be, don't be afraid of exploring. So anyhow, so I did poorly in finance when I was in college, but when I started to love public health, you know, what are the trends of like health issues, how do you deal with it, you know, a lot of different things, aspects of it. I did really well, I aced. So finance I did poorly, and so I learned over time that, hey, find your passion, as I said, and take your time, find your own way of helping out people, and you find your path.
I was solely focused on my studies because I didn't see anything that you said, you know, with CSR and whatever. But at that time, there's one thing I want to do. I don't want to. And I encourage you to set a target. Okay? Set a target. Let's say after you leave university, let's say in 10 years, what do you think you're going to be? I didn't have that. Nobody. At my time, we don't have this kind of session. We just go out there and then do what you have to do. And that was studying. Make sure you get a degree and get a job. At that time, I was thinking of more on the environmental side. I was studying in biology and zoology. Zoology is a study of animals. And I wanted to be a zoologist ever since I was at the primary school. From studying tigers, elephants, and all this and whatnot. So when I left, when I was at the school, I wanted to be a lecturer, teaching students. My parents were teachers, my grandmother was a teacher. But then when I left university, I wanted, So like Adrian said, do anything you want. I'm not asking you to be environmentalist, no. I'm asking you to do whatever you become, whether you are a cleaner or you are the PM of Malaysia, do something for the people. Okay, well, and like I said, do something which you believe is right. Even though a lot of people say you are wrong, do something which you believe is right. And I believe what Adrian is doing, a lot of people may disagree with him, but he goes on because he is doing his dream. And this is what I want every one of us to do based on education. I'm not going to tell you what to do. Like I said, education is about information dissemination. It's not about propaganda. Telling you what to do is propaganda. But education is giving you information, both positive and negatives, right and wrong, and you make your decision. If you make your decision, even though I disagree with you, I will say, go ahead, you know, that's what you believe and what is right.
Okay? I was a scout before. Anybody scouts? Scouts? Girl guides? Yeah. Shame on you guys. Girl guides and boy scouts today don't even have an environment badge. So at the time, back my is too long ago. When we go hiking, we go camping, all my seniors always said, hey, this place last time like that. Wow, last time this place got this. Wow, last time this place got this tiger, this got this tree, this waterfall. But why my time don't have? So then this curiosity from secondary school brought me to university level, then joined so-called green club, you know, or environment club. The question still sticks in my head. I said, hey, why has all these forests and environment degradations, forests disappearing, animals disappearing, something must be wrong somewhere, you know? So keep on volunteering, keep on joining environmental NGOs, keep on attending all these talks. But until one day I found out that this beautiful word called climate change. So, yes, we can solve individual problems, rivers, forests, in the environment, but when climate change comes, the balance will be disturbed. Everything will have to readjust. Everything will find a new balance, a new normal, adjusting to a new normal. So that's where I find an interesting new playground for me to learn more about climate change and stuff. So, what got me started is this watch. You know, it's like, hey, cannot tahan, why am I seeing it? I cannot see it. For me, it's very naive for me to start in that sense, but that's what drives me, that I want to see what my seniors before me see. So that's what drives me. I'm sure something else will drive you, whether it's your boyfriend or your girlfriend or your whatever, I don't know what sort of drives you to go to that something, but everyone always has to find that something, then probably you guys can go on. Yeah, so thank you much.
Very last thing is that you don't have to get a job right after you go to school. And this sounds, don't tell your parents I've ever said that. What I mean by that is I found out that I wanted to be in public health after I traveled in India, where, you know, I traveled and I made my parents really angry, but I traveled. But now I'm happier than many of my friends who stuck in their field and are just staying there and they're afraid of changing. So at this age, discover yourself, whatever that means. Like you said, volunteering at different places, traveling, and empathizing and talking to new people, whether it's talking to a homeless guy on the street or whether it's traveling to a new place. Okay? So don't be afraid and explore.
Session where we are asking students to live an extensive university life, to explore more, to get involved in more things, so that get out of just the focus on their academics. So I think this is a really good chance for everybody to get learn something out